All right, yeah, sounds good. Well, cool. Welcome to the next episode of Clinically Pressed. We're here with Jordan Rudolph and Unity Fitness in La Crosse and checking out the facility, gaining a little bit of knowledge. So thanks for being a guest, Jordan.
Thanks for stopping in. I appreciate it. Big fan of the show, so happy to be a part of it.
I want the backstory. On camera, on film, and also where you're located and the smell that you had to get rid of to make this place what it is.
Right. So the backstory is this is my, like, almost to the day now, 5 years in the personal training field. Started at Snap Fitness here in La Crosse, in La Crescent, as a one-on-one trainer. And there you kind of operate as your own business, your independent contractor. At the time, they've changed their business structure now, but essentially you grow into your own way of doing things. And the big part that I noticed right away is that I had a lot of catching up to, because there's a lot of guys that had more experience than me, so I had to learn from them. They were my closest resources, so I just shadowed as much as I could. Started off with like one or two clients. One's at 8 a.m., the other one's at 3:30, so it's like, what do you do with the other parts of the day? Hung out at the gym a lot, and just shadowed them. So I was just always watching them and getting to know them. And Randy Erickson was the head trainer at the time, and he's kind of my deemed first mentor. So I learned a lot of my stuff from him, but then I started looking into people that he was listening to and reading about, and he'd always reference names. So I figured I should probably start knowing some names and getting in that side of things. So it fast forward a few years, I became the head trainer. Everyone basically left except for two or three of us, and we were recruiting in a bunch more trainers to fulfill the population in our gyms. And what I struggled with the most was that every, like, you ask a person how to squat, or if you ask a person a nutrition question, how much water drink a day, like, even something as simple, what I would deem as simple, is that there's different answers for all of us, which really frustrated me, scared me, because I was getting clients from trainers that left, and I was handing some of mine down to the new trainers that were well along their way, or that we were a better fit, and all of a sudden they're coming back to me like, hey, he's having me do this, and you've never had me do it before because you told me that. So it was frustrating. Mm-hmm. So I knew that we needed to train our trainers in a different way. So I started working on a progress into that type of system for our trainers itself. But being independent contractors, they didn't have to listen to me. They just had to fill their quotas. So I started Unity Fitness as an online training program for people that either left Snap or for family that traveled somewhere else and they wanted to still have my services but didn't feel like it was right for them to do it for free. And we kind of went through the whole thing like, yeah, if you do it for free, you usually don't have that like value attachment to it too. So we started working through that. And a guy that was doing some classes with me found me online and was interested, just get a program developed, and it was Unity to be like the program, the nutrition, and the support. So they have constant email access to me, but then once a week or once every 2 weeks, depending on the type of package that they bought, we would have a 45-minute, half-an-hour conversation on the phone to get some goals, some weekly goals, some weekly habits established. And this guy brought it up to the owner, and the owner took it as I was starting to pick people out of the gym. So it put me in a very awkward position, and him too. Like, it was a tough position all the way around. Like, it never was my intention to do it that way. So it was just best that if I wanted to continue that route and make Unity Fitness a thing, which at that time in my life, it was like online training, like, this is the future, I quit. So just showed up one day and just said, here are my papers. Like, I think it's just best that we both part ways. Here are all my clients' information, alphabetical order. Like, I'm trying to organize it the best I can. Mm-hmm. But I just left. And all of a sudden clients are calling me and asking what happened, where are you going, like, what are you doing? Like, we heard this, we heard that. Like, okay, so I had to kind of clean some things up, but it was just in the best interest at that moment. So then I started online training. I went through that for about 2 months, and I helped start a gym in Caledonia on their personal training system, Lifestyle Fitness. And then I started getting kind of back into that whole training thing again, like, man, like, if we could just do it like in groups. Like, right before I left, I started pooling people together because I wanted to work with more people and more of my clients wanted to come back to me. And if you do one-on-one, you can't see everybody. And people started wanting to come in like two or three times a week, sometimes four, and they hated doing stuff on the off days. They didn't like going on the elliptical and doing their intervals or doing their steady states, whatever it is. So I started thinking about, like, man, do we go out to California, to be next to like my mentors that, again, self-deemed, but all the online mentorship that I did with Alan and Rachel Cosgrove, Dean Somerset, like it was just like, do we go to California to be closer to that and learn from them and just be in the action and grow that way and then always come back here, or do we just try this out, see it through? Decided to stick in Lacrosse and give it a shot. Filled everything for the SBA, looked through a bunch of locations. This was actually always number one. And this one ended up being the one that fell through, or everything else fell through, and this one ended up being the one that just stayed. So SBA happened, signed the lease in here the next day, and we were in the next day, like finally knocking down the walls that I've been looking at for like 4 months. I can't wait to get my hands in that wall. I can't wait to get my hands in that wall. So we have a video of me just taking the hammer and just sludging the wall. So this was all in here. This was all like elevated flooring. There was a counter back here. There was walls separated through the whole thing. So we knocked a bunch of stuff down. And we went in the old Pleasening building. And they had seasonings here for about 34 years. And there is the back room, which is where their mixing room was. The walls were supposed to be like an ivory color, and they were like brown or orange. The seasonings were against the wall. So we tried like wiping it off one day and didn't make a dent. So we had to call somebody in, and he brought in like industrial grade car cleaning stuff that they use on like farm equipment.
Wow.
And a power pressure washer to knock this whole thing out and like clean it all up. And each day, like, we're just like, man, that smell's got to go. Like, nothing against the Pleasenings, but the smell has to go. Yeah. It was strong. And it was in our noses. Like, I'd blow my nose, and it'd be, like, Pleasening, and it's on my clothes. It's in my car. Like, it was just, life was Pleasening then.
Can't get away from it.
Right. The eyes were turned orange. It was pretty bad. And, jeez. So we're just hoping, like, one day it's going to go away. And I started noticing, I thought, like, hey, I think the smell's getting better. We gutted, like, everything we could. The carpet, the flooring, except for like the tile that you see here, but everything we could got washed, and we repainted, we primed everything, and then one day somebody next door said like, hey, I don't really smell that smell anymore. So I'm thinking like, please let it go. And the only spot you can really smell it at the gym is on a hot summer day now, and it's as soon as you step inside the door, there's the little brick, like laminate flooring there.
Okay.
And it's underneath that flooring.
Oh,
but
really?
If you don't know what the smell is, as soon as you step by it, you're done.
Nice.
So you don't smell it anymore.
Okay.
Manageable.
Yeah. But the number one, like, out of all the things that could have happened in a business side of things, like, seriously, the smell was, like, our biggest
insane.
Fear. Like,
that's
we're not going to get rid of that.
Could be worse, though, in the grand scheme.
Right,
of,
right.
You know,
and it was funny because we were going through, like, oh, we're going to make this work. Like, we'll do it. We'll have clients that come back to me. Like, we'll be okay. But that smell's got to go. You know, like, they'd come in here to give a tour, and they'd see where we're at in our progress, and like, you guys gonna get rid of that? Like, yeah, we're working on it.
Not enough Febreze in the world.
Right. No. But man, I remember like telling her, Mandy, my girlfriend who's also the manager, like telling her, like, I think it's getting better. She's like, no, I think you're just getting used to it.
Yeah, you know? I could see that.
Got no stuff.
So we brought Unity Fitness to a physical location, and Unity still stood for something. But it couldn't just be, like, when we first started, it still was, like, nutrition, exercise, support. Like, that was Unity. It was a full circle of everything that you need to get results. And shortly after we started, I realized that it's more than that now. Like, I wanted them, like, they're coming to us for exercise. Like, they know that already. So if we can give them accountability and results and community and support, that'll kind of create the Unity effect. And that's now what kind of Unity represents to that extent, where the results encompass the exercise and the nutrition. But now they have the accountability with us, as everyone here has a coach that they can refer to, or coaches, you know, it's not just one coach, and it's not just my way, it's our way. So it's kind of like Unity Fitness is our vision, so we squat the way Unity Fitness wants us to squat. You know, so it's not my thing, even though that's like, we all get together and we talk like they, when we're squatting, this is how it should look like. This is what we need to help people with. If they have some sort of dysfunction, this is how we help them. And we do it in a collaborative effort, so there's not just one person saying, like, hey, this is how I squat. This is how I want you to squat. This is how we're going to get you to squat here. It's always we. It's always us. It's always a team effort. And there's no more, you know, they go to him and it's he's saying this, and they go to her, he's just saying that, where we just help them all as a whole. And if we don't know a question, one of the coach doesn't know an answer to a question, we can just refer to the other coach. And if we all don't know, then we're gonna, probably all of us in here will be looking it up that night for research base, you know, and then we're coming back and we'll end up all sending an email to the member.
So not to place all the blame on Snap Fitness or anything, but how would you say that you guys are different or better than more of the commercialized fitness industry or the way they do things? The
community thing.
The community thing is huge. So that's a huge part of it. You know, it's not where everyone comes in here, we know their name, and we know probably five things about them. And it's not just me, all of our staff. Like, that's something that we pride ourselves with, where we actually, like, log that information. But we get to know people on a personal level. And we've had several members that have been to different gyms in the area and in the country, and they've noted how they, just the fact that we know their name when they come in, or we say bye to them by name, like, makes their day. Or when we greet them with a smile as they come in. So that's a huge thing for us. That's what we coach all of our people on, all of our employees on in here. But we also have the people in here, the members in here, that know all the other members. You know, it's that type of community too. It's not just the staff pushing it forward, it's the members engulfed in it as well. So there's that part of it. And the other part of it is the individualized level. We really, really, really try to get to know them through and through on everything that we could possibly know. Like, our whole interview process is just getting to know the person. And we do, of course, the health history stuff along the way, but they're asking questions that they said, like, doctors ask them, and that their significant others ask them. Like, they don't even know the answer. You know, they're like, oh, my husband's never even asked me that. Okay, like, that's fine. Like, now you can tell them what the answer is, you know?
Yeah,
and,
sure.
But it allows us to get to know them, because in the grand scheme, the more we know, the more we can individualize, and the more we can make this about them, and we can make the program that more specific to them too. And that's something that I think it's just in the personal trainer nature in me. Like, I've always tried to do that, but that's something that we just mainstream now. So it's just our process. It's just what we do. Mm-hmm.
So what's the process look like if someone's wanting to come to the gym? What do you take them through, or
so that's probably the biggest thing, because they first come in and they don't see, like, the machine. So that's still that happens almost every week. We have somebody come in and they walk right by me, and they'll come to this back room and they'll go to the classroom in the back and they'll, where's your machines?
Right.
We don't have any. Yeah. You know, and like, oh, so you're CrossFit? Well, we're not CrossFit, but we do similar stuff. Oh, so you're boot camp? Well, we're not boot camp, but we do similar stuff. You know, so they don't really know what we do. So we sit them down and we ask them what their goal is. That's the biggest thing. We got to know what their goal is, so we know we're starting how to help them. We go through the whole physical activity readiness questionnaire to make sure that they're ready to be going into an exercise program. And then they get a functional movement screen. They do it on their initial visit. If they come in gym clothes, like, we're doing it on the spot. Otherwise, we'll bring them back in as soon as we can to do that right away. And then we get their goals written down on a sheet of paper, and if they want to, they stay here, they don't stay here, they can take that sheet with them, because that's important. But we also figure out their why, like, what brought them in the door, why is that their goal, why is that important to them, why is that going to make you feel better, why is, you know, just, we keep asking why in a few different ways just to get them really motivated and ready to take that action step. And I always tell them, like, hey, it doesn't have to be with us, and if it's not with us, like, I'll find a place for you to go. But the process is they do that, they come in here, movement screen, package, and if they do the package, like, they can either come back to a class that night if their movement quality is well, they're not in any injury, medical issues or anything like that, or we're training the next day if we can. And then they get an assessment with our with the physical therapist that works here, Matt Habrill, Dynamic Physiotherapy. Everyone gets free assessments with him as being a member here, so we get to do a double check with him. He can obviously take the screening process quite a few steps further than I can, legally and otherwise. Yeah. So he can check all that other good stuff out, and he helps develop our programs with us too. If there's anything that we need to know that I can't screen for, that he can find out, we just keep that process pushing forward. That's basically, we don't do any assessments of sorts. We used to. Our biggest assessments now are the programs. Like, we see it in the programs, we see them getting stronger. They feel themselves getting stronger. They see themselves getting better. We do some assessments later on, like with body fat percentage or girth measurements. We can do cardiovascular tests if they want to, but a lot of times, like, that person's just ready to go. They don't care what the numbers say. If they ask, we'll certainly do it. But otherwise, we're trying to get them roaring as soon as we can.
Do you re-movement screen them just as, you know, like a year out, 6 months out, or whatever it is? I know we've run into that doing it with our athletes. How often do we do it?
Yeah. So we have it set up where we can do it every 6 weeks.
And
the programs, we have it that soon, but we only pick like one or two things to rescreen.
Right.
The priorities.
Like the big findings.
Right. Yeah. Yep. And if we see that there's like two or three in a row where they're not getting anything, we'll just take it all away and we'll do it in like three phases. So 12 weeks. We'll do it in three phases. And we're actually seeing better results doing it that way. Where we used to do it every 6 weeks and people weren't quite at that point yet. And then we get to that 12th week and they're kind of there, but they're still, you know, we see better movement. Maybe they're not in pain anymore. Maybe there's a better form overall, but we're seeing better movement screen results now, like doing it every 3 months, like every 12 weeks, essentially, is what the programs. They go through two phases. So when they start their third phase, it happens in the fourth week. We go through 6 week phases. And so it'll essentially be week 16. We rescreen like the two big priorities, and we've just had, we have 10 people now, I think, in the gym that are above a 17.
Wow.
Which is like a big deal for that aspect of things, for movement quality. There's a lot that fall below the 12. Our general score, average score in the gym is below 12. It's like an 11 and a half.
Okay.
So we're getting more towards like that 17, 18 mark. Like we're seeing it more and we're retesting it. I'm putting them all into our computer and re-adding them up. And we just now, I found a crack that I think actually last week, like Thursday or Friday.
Nice.
I had another person screen it. Yeah. So, and it's a testament to the program too. Like if we're not getting that part done, like we're failing. Like we're not getting them quite where they need to be.
Yeah, so they always say, you know, don't put strength on a bad movement pattern. Right. You're just going to further ingrain it.
Right.
Yep.
And I think a lot of times we get so progressive with that. Like we see the person like moving forward so quickly in one area where we get caught. You know, we want to keep moving them forward in that area because they feel good about it too. And then we kind of forget that there's also this to take care of. You know, so it's easy to be like, yeah, let's do this next on the next phase and let's have her doing this or let's have her doing that. And then we're like, oh yeah, like, we still have to correct this issue.
Yeah.
How does that work to, like, sell is not the right word, but I'm going to use it anyway, that to people that things are going well, but hold on a second, like, we got to come back, and it's small, and it's, it could be small, and it could be very intrinsic, but it's still a focus. I know, like, with our athletes, like, you try and slow them down because they think they got to have a 400-pound squat, and it's just like, well, you can't even sit down properly.
Yeah.
But to bring them back, like, how have you addressed that?
One of the big things that we use right away is kind of like using all-star athletes or Hall of Fame athletes, how they, the Hall of Famers are a Hall of Famer for a reason. It's because they do all the little things right. Like they're in here, if we think there's a Hall of Fame for strength training, you know, or functional training, whatever you want to deem this, there's guys in there that they'll tell you they're in the gym every day working on their mobility, working on the little things that'll create a bigger gain in the long run. So we use that analogy a lot, you know, like Michael Jordan's an easy one to use as the analogy, and like, hey, he was shooting free throws every day, he was working on his jump shot, you know, just all those little tiny things that really get him to that next level. And the other part is, does it matter to you to squat 400 pounds tomorrow, or does it matter to squat 400 pounds for the rest of your life? So right. we use that one a lot too.
Nice.
And just so you can do it in 20 years from now. Or, you know, obviously we're not working with too many athletes here, so it's a little different conversation. Like, hey, does that squat really matter to you that much, or does playing with your grandkids in 20 years at a level where you can play with them on the floor and not be in pain?
How are you going to feel?
Matter more, yeah. And they understand it. Like I said, we have a lot of like-minded individuals here, so there might be some initial resistance, but they get it. You know, it's just the emotional response, and
so is everybody's program similar, or based on their goals, do you have like entirely different for each specific person, or how does that work?
Most people in our gym have a fat loss program. So we have a template that I follow that I essentially created, and it goes through 10 phases, so it's 60 weeks worth of work that they just keep developing and growing and maximizing, transforming. There's an athletic template that I created, and then there's just a feel better one where They all have similar characteristics, but the athletic one will have more power components, more unilateral stuff, and then it's sport-specific exercises on there. So we'll leave in the template, we'll leave spots open for sport-specific push or sport-specific pull, whatever it is going to be. And then in the feel better, that one's more of like just strength training. There's not as many finishers or energy systems trainings at the end of the workout where we're trying to burn them out.
Yep.
It's more strength-based. You know, the reps stay between 6 and 12, but we scheme it differently. And then the fat loss goes through a lot of core work and a lot of energy system stuff where we follow, we've tried two different methods. We follow like an undulating program where we just kind of pick random reps and we go with that for 6 weeks. And right now we're in a pretty strict and linear one that has actually seen better results, especially for our new people. And research has shown that too. That's why we switched over to it. They see better results if they just do something over and over, and they can increase their strength. Like if you can add 5 pounds, keep adding 5 pounds. Keep adding 5 pounds.
They get that neuromuscular adaptation, right. And they're and let so, it build up. And once they get the strength,
and they're so ready for it when they're new.
Yeah,
yeah. It just like you just go. You know, you just go. Like we had a lady in here last night that she's in her 12th week with us this week. She had an awesome session last week, and she followed up again last night with just an unbelievably, like you can just tell, like when that person's just ready to just erupt, and she's doing it, and she knows it too, so she is just like on cloud nine, and we were looking at the programming, so with the coaches, write the progressions for the following week, and we almost always do a deload at some point within a six-week phase, and it almost always comes after an overload, or right before, we kind of wait to see what the person's got going on in their life, or how they're doing, and he's like, so she's due for a deload, but I think we should keep it going. And I was like, yeah, like we gotta keep this train rocking. So she's gonna go a couple more weeks for an overload just because she's so focused right now. It's funny, it's like she had so much stuff outside of the gym happen. Like we thought like, okay, let's take it back a little bit. We'll kind of help her out. And she's like, ever since that stuff's happened, totally different animal in here. Like she's generated that energy into this and it's growing. And she's doing a fat loss. She's doing a fat loss template, but that's the biggest difference. And then we'll have a post rehab one as well. I'm actually trying to develop that one right now. The hard part about that is that that one's so specific that we kind of have to wait to see what's going to like come into before we start on it. So we're developing more of like that type of thing, but not so focused on. It's more about post rehab. Maybe even consider like pre-rehab in some aspects, exercises instead of like the full-blown strength training. So we're generating more of that now. We're helping the coaches out with new types of mobility exercises or post-rehab stuff that I know from my education at UWL for pre-PT and obviously Matt Averill comes into a big play in that too. So there's four, I guess, big templates: the fat loss, the feel better, and then the athletic, and then the post-rehab. Most people, I would say like 75%, 80% are on the fat loss one. Some of them just restarted, so they got through their full 10 phases, so they're back to phase one going after it again.
Yeah.
So do they work out at the same time and do more group training, like you mentioned earlier?
Yeah, everything's done in groups. They can actually pick whatever time works best for them in the schedule. So they'll have the ability to, for personal training, they'll see like when all of our coaches are available. And they can just pick when they want to come in. And then if there's four people or more in that given hour, it'll lock the hour down. So you can't sign anymore. So we do everything training-wise in small groups. So when you guys first came in, there was Pat, Tony, and Eric. That was a training session. Each person had a different program that they were running. And Mitch was just executing it. And they'll do that program for 6 weeks. And then in six weeks, we'll give them a new one. And they'll start all over. And then there's classes that accommodate that, too. So the classes were originally designed for that whole gap where, like when I was doing training at SNAP, we're like, what do I do on my off days? Like the classes that we had here were originally their off day stuff. So we thought like, oh, if we could do training on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, we'll just have all of our classes on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. And that doesn't work out. You know, ideally that'd be a perfect schedule, but now the classes have become like their own thing. And there's several members here that just do the classes themselves to get the results they need. They don't want the personal training, or they're not wanting to do that investment for the personal training yet. But they they love the classes, they love the team aspect of it. We kind of call it team training or large group mm-hmm. training, where there's more of the energy, more of the high intensity, where the semi-private stuff is more focused. You know, it's that's where a lot of our heavy stuff is happening, and more of the corrective stuff and individualized stuff. But we do bring that over into the classes, so we limit them to 12 people or less, so we can keep an eye on everybody. That was one of my big things too. I didn't want to have like a class of 20 to 30 people where we can't see, and I didn't want to ever have that person that came in like their first class and never have any interaction with the coach. Like that drove me nuts when I hear about that with people. Like, like always got to talk to the coach. The coach has always got to be able to see you. So that's a big thing for us. We were really focused on that component, so we can keep everything personal and individualized, but also keep it results focused too. And the community aspect. I mean, a lot of these people that we see have been to several different gyms, again, in the area, and they come in and they've never had a coach talk to them. They sign up for a class and they go in there, and then we have one of ours say, like, hey, you know, I'm Mitch, nice to meet you. I'm Jordan, nice to meet you. How, you know, is there anything I need to know about you today in regards to your body? Like, how are you moving? Have you done anything like this before? And they don't know what to say. And they're like, oh, I've never been asked that before. But I've done 10 classes, you know, so... again, it's just that personal approach of it. And the classes are all generated for, it's a general workout, but we have some that are more for high intensity interval training, some that are like core engagement dynamics activation, like we're just working through the core itself more than just abs, like working on their glutes and their hips, mobility of it, stability of it. There's a mobility class. There's pump, which is kind of like our strength class, more focused on like eccentrics and technique-based lower reps, and then our hybrid's a combination of like a sweat and a strength, so we just kind of put it all together. They'll do eight reps of rows and follow that with, you know, some sort of cardio movement, medicine slams, battle ropes, kettlebell swings, something to get their heart rate up, and then just bonus with it that way.
Do you have a most popular class that people tend to gravitate towards?
I would say sweat. Like, yeah. Like everyone likes that super high energy, like to go.
Instant gratification, yep. Working hard.
Yep. Yep. And that's
sweating,
like,
it must mean you got a good workout.
Right.
Right. Exactly.
You gotta be sore the next day.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's a conversation that we've had to have with a lot of people, like where they come in and they overtrain. You know, they're coming in and they're trying to go balls to the wall, where it's like, hey, you don't always have to go 120 miles per hour, but you can always give me 110% effort. Like, you can stay there, but the intensity can be, you know, where it needs to be for you. We give that heads up to everybody starting a class, you know, because sometimes they're coming in and there's somebody there 110, and then there's somebody next to them going 60, like, which one am I going to do? You know, so I just do what you're supposed to do. And again, that's why we keep them smaller, so we can help that person where, you know, they go into the class with people that have been working out for a few years, they're gonna try and run, you know, run during the class and do all that stuff where we gotta make sure that there's modifications. So every class has, every exercise in every class has a progression and a progression. So we know we have a sheet that watches everybody, and we have an injury risk sheet. So if someone's coming in, they're new, or if something happened in the gym here, outside of the gym, the coach can look that up and see anything new that's happening, so they know right away what they can or can't do with that person. And then right on the sheet itself, like, you see the progression and the progression. So it's a quick fix if that ever does come into play. Or areas of focus. If someone needs to work on core, it's really like just give them core exercise. Like a plank is hands down, you know, like one of the best exercises out there, and not a lot of people like to do them because they're hard. So we were like, hey, let's hold a plank for 30 seconds instead of doing kettlebell swings today. Or let's do dowel hinges instead. Or let's do toes elevated, toe touch progression, or hip hinge. You know, something to get the pattern developed more for them. We try to make those changes on the fly so that we don't have to take any seconds off watching people. So it's 45 minutes of class, and it picks up pretty quick, especially the sweats.
Yeah.
They go, you know, it's 30 seconds go, and they, like, some people are gone.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's a tough conversation, you know, on overtraining and what it actually means to have a program built for you based off of our classes, even though they have access to them every day. Like, that's tough, because sometimes they go to the pump and they don't get as much sweat going. They're not as sore the next day. Because we're working on mobility and strength.
Sure.
Wasn't supposed to be, you know. 1,000 reps and stuff.
Training versus working out, right? Yeah. Convincing there's people a plan. That there has to be that. You can't. And yeah, I can imagine your difficulty because I know ours trying to explain that.
Yeah, that's a tough conversation to have. That one's probably been the most difficult with our members.
Right.
You know, because all they think is like they got to work harder. So we got to make sure that we're setting them down like, hey, we can be smarter too.
Right. Sure. Yeah. So what's the nutrition aspect that you do? Is that kind of a individualized thing, or do you just kind of have like a general program that you recommend people follow, where you just kind of have them come in and do a class for them or something?
We follow more of the PN, the precision nutrition method, where we are trying to locate potentially limiting factors in their lifestyle. So we deem it as like we personal train. And we personal coach for nutrition. So just like they get personal training sessions, you get personal nutrition sessions where everyone's different. And we do an assessment when they first come in, and I just want to know their understanding of food. And a lot of times it's just the understanding of food that is our biggest setback, just in society itself. There's so much out there about the quick fixes and about like, oh, eat this, don't eat that. Like, people just get confused because it's everywhere. And they're coming in here with loads of knowledge, but they don't know what it means. So I just try to harness that. And you really start just by looking at a plate and realizing like what's on their plate is a big step. And then water, like those are huge things. But we go more for limiting factors. And then I try to give them one or two habits like every 2 to 3 weeks to focus on to help squash those limiting factors. We don't ever tell anybody that they can't eat anything besides trans fat. Like, I tell them to run from that. Like, we...
I think the consensus is pretty strong.
Yeah, right. But we don't tell them no, because that kind of has that negative effect again. So we just coach them on what they can do in replace of that as a substitution. And then we go to those habits, and they log for us. We're checking in. A lot of times they'll send me, like, a weekly update, or I'll ask them, like, hey, how are your habits going along when I see them in here? And then if they say, like, oh, they're all right, show me. You know, so then they have to show me proof, and they just go in that circle. And then when they get those down, like, things are moving forward, then we find some new habits. But we don't like to overload them on that right away, because then they're trying to do too much at once. So we try to just go one or two habits at a time. And the habit coaching is kind of what Precision Nutrition founded their whole coaching system on. So when I was looking into the nutrition certification, I actually started following like nutrition stuff from bodybuilders. So I would actually just pick bodybuilders' brains because they were like the most strict, dedicated people out there. Like, never missed the meal, like macronutrients. Like, I thought like you had to count everything, like this is it. And then I started realizing right away, every bodybuilder started telling me something different, and it does not work with general pop. Unless they wanted to do bodybuilding, you know, and they wanted to go through that. And they didn't have, they weren't ready for that type of dedication. So I started searching around, and then one of the other trainers at SNAP got a PNL1 started, and I looked at his curriculum, his book, and they had a whole half of the book on like how to just talk to people and coach people, and done. Like, the next day I enlisted, and 6 months later I got the certification. We're now using Pro Coach, which is their online software. We're just about to actually release that in the gym, and that's an online 52-week curriculum that members can follow, and then I oversee that part of it. But it's the same thing, like they fill out a questionnaire, a huge customized thing, and then they start at whatever level that kind of questionnaire puts them at, and then I'm just overseeing their progress as we go through. And it's the same stuff that PN uses for their, like, all of us could just go and become a client of PN right now. It's their same curriculum. So I'm excited for that, because it's going to be able to have more of an accountability factor for the nutrition for the members that need it. And then we don't have to do so much one-on-one, because all of our nutrition stuff is done one-on-one. That one I don't do in groups. It's too individualized, but I used to think exercise was like that too, and then we kind of do things in groups. But we do all that one-on-one. A lot of that more is, like, I feel is more private stuff, you know, with our members, like the nutrition side of things. There's medical things that come into play. There's family things that usually come into play. Their work, you know, they don't tell you about that when they're squatting or planking. But when you're doing nutrition stuff, they'll tell you. So we go a lot more with the habit-focused. One or two things every couple weeks, and if they accomplish it, then we keep going forward. But if it's hard for them, then we dial it back. Like, okay, let's look at this. Like, look what happened when we tried to do this. You started doing this, so that's actually not our focus. Like, this is. And we'll give them habit B to follow instead. And it's not a numbers thing at all. It's just, again, first part of it starts with education. So we're, a lot of times we're a teacher in the nutrition, just educating them what food is, what food does, and getting the mindset shifted a little bit. And ironically now, I think when I first started 5 years ago, we were seeing most people overeating. Now we're seeing most people are undereating, which is a totally different concept when you're talking to them. Now that you see it and they're eating 700, 800 calories a day. When I first started, I remember people were logging in like 1900 or 2600. And now I wish like some of them would eat that much, you know, because they're working out 6 days a week. All right, how do we get to this? What?
Yeah. You know,
like that, it's out of this realm. Like it's almost like you did something just completely terrible to them. And you tell them like, yeah, let's get closer to 2000. And they have no idea how to get there. So that's how we coach them how to get there.
You might be able to relate to that a little bit.
Yeah, it's just amazing that people think that's the answer. Just kind of starve yourself and
work harder, starve yourself.
Yeah, right.
Fitness in a nutshell.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
Yeah, it's gotten to that. It's tough.
It's even worse with athletes. You see a bigger gap in, you know, what they're eating versus what they should be. And I'm just amazed at how well people can still function. It's like, how are you able to do what you do when you don't eat that much? It's like, wow.
Yeah, we have a lot of women in here. We're primarily women. And we call it mommy syndrome. Like, they're just going to do it. It just has to get done, you know. They train at 5 a.m. They're going to get up at 4 a.m. every day to be here at 5, and they're going to do it off of 500 calories or 2,500 calories. Like, mommy syndrome. Like, it's just mommy drive. It's done.
Yeah. Whole other gear.
Yeah. And you know, now it's, the industry's looking into more of, like, adrenal fatigue, which they're calling adrenal insufficiency, learned last week. And
that's a whole other can of worms.
Oh, yeah.
You start tapping into the endocrine system, and
it's,
things are going to get crazy.
It is, and I think we're going to see more and more of it. Like, the fitness industry has grown 3% in the last year, so instead of having, you know, we're 10%, 12% of the population's ever had a gym membership, like, we're at 15, 16 now, which has been the most it's ever been. Large part to CrossFit, but in large part to education of the consumer. You know, there's more and more people growing to it, so.
Can't wait to see what the genetic component brings into it.
So yeah.
That keeps growing, both on the nutrition and the training side.
Right.
You're able to type someone what training is going to work best.
I don't know if
we can get any more specific than that. I know they're already out there testing it. Not that.
Yeah. Still got a ways to go.
I was saying, that's the thing. The group that I follow in India is it, but that you can go in and get a genetic test to see if your endurance, which isn't exactly groundbreaking because there's ways you could do it, but if you don't have to get a
muscle
if you don't need to go get your quad take
swap test
to know that would be nice. I mean, that's not the most fun feeling ever, but
yeah,
it'll be really interesting because I know we looked at the nutrigenomics, just morbid curiosity, and then I think the blood testing is going to be the other big swing. The wellness effects of the world and all those, where
that's where it's going to go.
It's
all leading towards that. All the other answers are being solved.
Yeah.
And then when the system breaks and we have to figure it out from there, it'll be just a free for all.
Yep.
So
that's one of the big gaps right now. I think there's so many people in the industry that think that they're doing it the only way it's supposed to be done. Like, it's their way and it's the right way because they're getting results. But the results are, like, I think results should be the easiest thing to get if we just bring them down to a level where they understand everything and we all work together.
Right.
But there's so many people that think, like, nope, it's just this, or it's just that.
Right.
I can't do mobility because I'm this person.
We talk about it with diet all the time. Like, there's so many options out there, you know, paleo, ketogenic.
Right.
I think the ketogenic diet is an extremely interesting thing, and but it's not going to work for everybody.
Right.
It just isn't. And that's okay. And I think that's where you got to be
open-minded.
Trying to put people in kind of... whether it's a good thing or not, be almost like a jack of all trades of it.
Yeah.
Because you need to figure out, well, if that's not working, what tweak can we do?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where you're going to get really good. And I'm sure you've seen the same thing with all the training in here.
Exactly.
I can be better at volume, and you may be better at intensity, and we both get the same results. We both get stronger.
I think the biggest thing is just knowing who you're listening to when you get that advice.
No, like, that's
are they true. Someone who is going to force you into, no, this is the only way you're going to get results, or are they willing to work with you and find an individualized plan?
I had a post ready that I didn't get done. We went to a commercial gym, we'll just say that, when we were in Kansas City, and I can't help but watch. Like, right. it kills me. And I was working out with my buddy who's a muscle and fitness kind of, he's really gotten into it, but that's his, bodybuilding.com, T-Nation articles, but those are bad.
Yeah.
But that's what he gets his stuff from. Yeah. So it was like just little tweaks I was giving him to get him what he wanted, but I'm watching everybody else, and there was this mountain of a man that was a personal trainer. I mean, he was wearing boxing shoes, so I don't know if he's the world's biggest boxer or if he played football or what his deal was. But then there's a couple other ones, and one didn't fit the mold so much, but he was there, and he was employee of the gym, and just watching their personal training sessions, like, I watched this poor little man with this gigantic guy just go back and forth from leg extensions to walking lunges, which were terrible, and I just felt bad for his knees, to then going over and doing hamstring curls to standing calf raises on the machine, and they wandered over by the squat rack, but at that point I just stopped watching because I couldn't take it anymore. But it was just like, this poor guy, and he's like, oh, and I heard him joke one time, I guess that's why people hit leg day. I was like, you don't even know what you're talking about. Like, you're not even going to get the results that you think you want to get, and you're not going to look like that guy. Mm-hmm. But that's the guy's just like walking around, just making it up as he goes. There's no sheet, and it's just kind of like that. I feel so bad that you're wasting your money that I almost want to like pull you away and just say, can I just offer some advice? No cost. That's
the hardest part is not like that's what that person knows is fitness.
And that
they like it, or if they can't walk for 5 days, they think that that's what they know is fitness.
Right.
Or if somebody gets hurt in a high intensity class they go to for the first time, they're not coming back. Like, fitness has a negative connotation.
Right.
Like, now it's worse.
Yeah.
So that's the most frustrating thing in the industry right now.
And just do your homework on whoever you're paying for your services. Like, there's good and bad to everyone. Doctors, dietitians, trainers, coaches. Like, ask around, what's the reputation like?
Testimonials, things like reference.
It's tough. The industry's in a good spot of growth, but it's in a bad spot of education.
Right.
Like,
that's a good way to put it.
We can go get educated right now. You can get a CPT right now. Like, today I could go sign up for a...
Yep.
Like, my certification is actually an online certification I got while I was in school. And I knew it was crap. Like, I knew it was. And I still have it. Like, I just recert on that one. Like, someday I plan on going over when things kind of settle down a little bit. But I had UWL to help me out. I shadowed a bunch of classes there. And then I had all those mentors when I first started, which Randy is my big one. But started following all those people. And I'd like to say, like, I did pretty well with that part of it. But I don't recommend my certification to anybody. Like, I'm not even saying its name, but it's out there. Like,
yeah,
it's online.
Yeah.
Something to put, but you're doing your homework and doing other education.
Yeah, so it's doable. Like, you can do it, but it's just the fact that anybody can now just go get that, and then they're going to the next day, and they love exercise so much that's what brought them into it, but they don't know how to help somebody yet. And there's a lot of that. Like, there's some certifications you just go for a couple of days, and you can come back and then be a coach at big box gyms or anywhere else. It's scary.
Just because you pass the test doesn't mean you all of a sudden know it all.
Yeah.
I got put in my place multiple times.
Yeah.
As I figured that out. And it was good. It's made it to where I don't stop. Like, to the point now, I feel like I almost go too far. And you try and consume too much information, and you don't know what to throw a dart at. But,
that's good, though, because you don't know what you don't know.
Yeah, I almost have to, like, write down, because I've got so many references for exercises. I can't even think of them. I just don't even know where to start, so I have to make my own little list.
Yep, so you have something to look at, though.
That's my theory, anyway. So I appreciate you confirming that. That makes me feel better.
Yeah, it's super frustrating. So I sent it in a post a while ago on my Facebook page, but I had a friend who posted this, and I looked into our scores, and everyone who's, like, this is the first time they've ever been to a gym. We do their movement screen, we see their score. And then we have several members that have been a part of a gym, and they come in here, and we do their movement screen. The members that have been a part of the gym before coming to Unity have lower movement scores.
Interesting.
That is interesting.
And I couldn't believe it. Like my friend posted, like, there's no way. And I went and checked ours, and I didn't check them all, but I checked probably half. And
crazy.
Apps, and I'm like, man.
I believe it. I mean, you watch people just swipe in, hop on elliptical for a little bit, maybe do some
hit a couple machines,
leg extensions, and chest press, and they're out there.
I was thinking about that the other day, kind of like the evolution of fitness. You know, like machines were all the rage like years ago.
Nautilus boom.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Exactly. And then now it's, you know, free moving, functional, if you will, you know, CrossFit the whole bit.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
where are we going next?
Right. Like, in like 15 years, are we going back to machines? Like, I just, like, you know, like, where?
Underwater strength training.
Yeah.
There are just.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, there's some of it. I mean, there it is, but it's just kind of like, you know, everything kind of, like you said, ebbs and flows and whatever. And, you know, the same thing with nutrition. Like, is CrossFit going to stay around forever? God knows. Like,
it'd probably be like virtual reality e-stem or something like
that.
Just put on these goggles,
there's the
and then electrodes, and then you just like think you're moving, and it zaps you.
Squats are tough.
Yeah. Oh,
God, I'm so sore from standing here for 30 seconds.
Take the goggles off.
Hell of a workout.
Maybe they can incorporate an ARP into that, though.
Oh, God, I hope not.
Still the most popular video.
Did you see that clip when I did the ARP wave out in Madison?
It's a former student of ours, and he runs it's Madison Human Performance. That one's on us, Dan. And he's got this thing called an ARP wave, but it's a stimulant, but it's meant for like helping train like patterns.
Okay.
Well, he's got it does that, and it does like a quote unquote search and destroy, which is just as bad as it sounds. So you're finding trigger points, and it's lighting them up.
Oh,
think dry healing, but only with stim pads.
Right.
And so AJ kept volunteered for it, and it's a 20-minute video that I cut down because it took forever, and it's by far our most popular video.
I was dripping sweat.
He's hopping off the table, and I think it helped, and I think I understand where they're going
for sure
with it, and the thing makes sense, but
yeah.
Boy, was it an intense thing. I highly recommend that one because it is. Funny.
I wouldn't do that to your first day participants.
Right.
I'm joining the gym.
Yeah.
We're going to try this on you for your movement assessment.
Yeah.
And
see you later.
You're never going to have another
class. That's nuts.
But yeah, right. Yeah. Anyway.
It's interesting.
Yeah, I think that's the way to go. I was listening to Barbell Shrugged, and it attaches to your phone. God, I'm blanking on the name of it right now. But it's basically an eSTEM thing that runs off of your phone. Box or something like that. I'll have to look it up and put it in there. But it was just kind of an interesting concept. So they were taking off some of the recovery stuff and also just like what the Mark Pro has done and their own little version of it. And it was interesting and kind of a better than a TENS unit, but always with you. And I could see that becoming a thing.
Oh, yeah.
I think they had talked about training with it on it too and getting some benefit to it, which if you go all the way back to the original uses of like Russian stem.
Yeah.
That's what it's used for.
Right.
And we still use it. More for re-education after injury, but it's
a lot of people have been sedentary for so long it mimics an injury.
For sure.
Right.
Exhibiting dysfunction.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Yeah.
Well, get to our questions here, what do you think?
Sure, it's noon. I can get 5 more minutes off. Doc's already got my order for lunch training, so
no trans fat on there.
Yeah.
No, I actually ordered a salad.
What?
Nice. Wow.
Jeez.
I texted him. I said in
the on top of a burger or what?
Here is my order. It is a salad.
Extra meat.
Wow.
The scale scared me the other day.
No.
Real bad. I don't need to outweigh most of our linemen. But,
wow.
Anywho.
Anyone does at our school.
Yeah.
Sorry, coach.
First one we always ask, and I'm sure we've kind of covered it, but if you can summarize it, something that you believe in that others may not, and it really doesn't have to be fitness if you got something else, but
yeah.
Both if you want to, whatever, however you want to do it.
I think I've stuck to this since I remember like reading books that were kind of like the aha moment after aha moment after aha moment, and it's always being open-minded. And to me, that means always be listening first, like try to listen as much as you can, and just know that there's not one way that things might, that would be like the only way done. So there might be other possibilities. So our thing is like always be open concept, open-minded, always be willing to change and like grow within that, and keep watering the tree. And I think the story is actually about a bamboo stick or a piece of bamboo where you keep watering the bamboo, and after 4 years, like, it's, you know, it's 90 feet tall, but you water it every day. Like, water your tree every day. So whatever it is, like, your goal is, like, don't just stop because you don't see progress. Like, someday that tree will be, you know, 100 feet tall.
Okay.
Continue to push that and just be open-minded to the different ways, you know, to water it. And mastermind and with people. And I say mastermind because I don't like networking as much. Like, I don't like the term. Like, it just doesn't feel good to me on that.
Feels kind of rigid.
Yeah. So I've mastermind with people. Yeah, right.
You're in my network.
Yeah. after reading Napoleon Hill's book, Think and Grow Rich, I think he's the one that has, like, a whole, like, chapter on it. But just the power of mastermind, but just like-minded individuals after a common goal and working together with it. There's so many people that they meet somebody and they're like, yeah, no, I'm not going to give that guy any more of my time.
To you, and open the door, you know, the checking your ego. You know, opening your mind, checking your ego at the door. Everybody has a place. There's plenty to go around. So
yeah. So open concept, water the tree, and mastermind, like, as much as you can. And part of that's personal. Like, I used to think as an independent contractor when I first started, like, I was always doing my thing.
Right.
And not asking anybody for help, just kind of following the lines. And I did that at school too. Like, I think that got me in trouble at school a lot because I had no idea what I was doing. I just kept doing my own thing and meet with my advisor once a semester, and he's telling me stuff. I'm like, man, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. Like, that's a prerequisite for PT school. Like, I did that 2 years ago. Like, I'm applying. Like, I need this now. You know, I remember that moment too. So it's just masterminding, you know, using your resources and not being isolated.
You mentioned one, but other book recommendations?
Yeah. One of my favorites is Start With Why by Simon Sinek. That's, like,
good one.
One of my all-time favorite books, and he's one of my all-time favorite speakers. Like, I just listen to that guy all day. The One Thing by Gary Keller. There's the old school ones, How to Win Friends and Influence People, Dale Carnegie, and then Seven Habits of Highly Successful People by Steve Covey, and then Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. Like, those ones are kind of staples. I'm trying to reread Think and Grow Rich right now, or re-listen to. And then Tribes is, for some reason, like, some of these books just, like, resonate. I think they caught me at a good time because I was waiting to see if Unity Fitness was going to happen physically.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I just remember, like, diving into these books, like, hard, and I only was able to focus on the book where I didn't have a million other things going on, so I just, like, fully invested in the book.
I've heard good things about Tribes. Haven't read it yet.
It's super short. Yet. I don't remember who wrote it, though.
I'm blanking on it too, but the premise of it sounds really interesting.
Yeah, it's just cool. Like, essentially, it's the saying that the world needs leaders, but they need leaders because people need someone to follow.
Right.
And I remember, like, one of my biggest struggles, and it still is, like, is confidence. Like, I need confidence to be able to tell people certain things or to do more things or to take that next step. Like, that's why exercises worked for me. When I was in at UWL, like exercise helped me gain more confidence just to be able to, like, talk.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very outside of these doors. Like, I'm very reserved, like, very introverted, big time. inside these doors, different person. I have to be, though.
Right.
And I think Tribes really kind of flipped my mindset on that, and I'm trying to work more on the outside of the doors thing now. You know, a lot of times people are like, oh, I thought you were kind of an asshole because you didn't say hi. No, I just don't know what to say, man. I'm reserved. Like, I'm back. Like, sorry. You know, it's just my personality.
Apparently, I look pissed all the time.
I've gotten that before.
I'm just standing there. They're like, no, you look angry. I was like, no, I'm standing there. Like, I don't know what you want me to do.
Smile. When I drive, apparently I'm out.
You're just in the zone.
Sure, right? Yeah, I'm sure I'm mean mugging everybody when I drive. Yeah, I understand. Yeah.
So, those are big books. I'm reading a really good one right now called Beyond Discipline. It's part of our book club with a mastermind group that I'm in. And it's essentially how, like, moving beyond discipline in a classroom, like a school setting, and it's going through, like, all the different progressions of that over the last 40 years, but it's like a psychology book more towards that.
Okay.
Very interesting, community building.
I'm very interested in the psychology stuff.
Yeah, yeah. The mindset stuff is where a lot of my stuff has shifted to. I still read, like, fitness books. Like, I just finished Mike Boyle's, is the new edition of his Functional Training for Sports. I'm gonna do Brad Schoenfield's Hypertrophy. Yep. That's next on the list. I don't know how I missed that one in the last 5 years, but
I got so many of those.
Yeah.
That's not that new.
It just came out this year.
I feel a lot better then. Like, people have been talking about it for so long.
It just came out this year.
Oh, that makes sense. I was just telling her last night, like, I almost bought it. I'm like, I don't know how I haven't read this yet, you know, and people keep referencing it, like, everything I'm reading.
Yeah, it's a good review. It's a good resource.
Yeah. But yeah, like the mindset, the psychology part of books, motivational interviewing, like that stuff like really resonates because that's how I can coach people better. Like I feel like the exercise and the team that we have, the coaches that we can bring in, like it's more of like how do you coach people?
Oh yeah.
So it's getting
inspiring that motivation within them. Yes. I think that's a big challenge.
Yeah, the inspirational part is huge, huge in here. So we have like most of the people that work here, the coaches that we've had in here are all introverts too, which is really funny.
Yeah.
But
I'm just envisioning walking in and everyone's just quiet.
So it's really funny. Like in here, we have to be somebody else, and we've had different coaches come in where they couldn't quite get to that point yet. Where we're like, hey, like, we need you to be more. Like, oh, it's just not me. It's okay. Like it's just what we need.
Yeah.
But it's like I said, like outside of here, I'm a totally different person. Inside of here, they just know me as this person, like high energy, like motivational, but inspirational. Like it resonates through 95% of our clients. Because a lot of times when they come into the gym, like it's at the lowest point they've ever been. You know, they don't ever want to be told that they have to go to a gym. So a lot of our pursuit is catching them on the proactive side of that. Like, let's not ever have to be told that you have to do that. So let's get you in now and battle that part of it. And how do you inspire them where the gym becomes a positive thing, like a fun thing, so then we can tackle all the other outside stuff like the nutrition, the recovery, the support.
I see that. What's a fitness recommendation, or I guess I shouldn't say fitness, but a purchase for under $100?
Oof. I saw that question on there, and I kept thinking, like, what would I say? I still think a foam roller.
Yeah?
I just...
Solid.
I just love the foam roller.
Yep.
We were acknowledging the rack over there. I've never seen that before.
That's nice.
That's a good one.
I'm going to give them a free one, too, and we'll cover this when we talk to them. Rove rollers. Guy I went to college with started. It actually unfolds.
I saw it for the travel, right?
Yeah.
Put it in like your suitcase and it's flat and then it snaps up into
a foam roller. Looks pretty impressive.
I think I saw you doing that.
I'm really waiting for that to show up. Yeah. I think it comes in March, so.
Awesome. So we got funded, right? It was like a Kickstarter program he was doing?
Yep. They got funded and then some, so yeah. I'm excited to see it.
Yeah.
Awesome. I've heard good things.
I think they'll be successful with that
one. Yes, foam rollers for sure.
Yeah, there's so much magic that you can do with it, especially if you take it with you.
Right.
Where
you
go.
Yeah.
When we travel, I'm always like, man, we bring lacrosse balls. We've got a little like one that we use. Now we go to gyms a lot, so we just hop on one there or go to a gym that has them there. But I'd say probably a foam roller.
It's a good pick.
Foam roller or something like that.
Cool. We have any other questions?
Yeah.
Is that it?
If you could go back in time 10 years, what kind of advice would you give yourself?
The networking one, the mindset, the masterminding with people, use your resources. Like I kept thinking like it was me flying solo when I first started college. It got me into a lot of holes.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't use the resources like I had there. Like I was pretty bitter at UWL for a while, you know, just UWL. It doesn't matter, just UWL. And it's funny, like, I see myself, like, saying that, and I hear myself saying that, like, gosh, that's terrible. But it was me, like, I just thought I could just do my own thing, cruise through like I did at high school, you know, where it was a different story where I could just do the homework the night before and not have to worry about anything, go and ace the test and get out of there with the diploma. And applying yourself enough to be into a masterminding type of environment or like a networking environment is big. Like I'm still very poor at the networking aspect. Like unfortunately I'm too busy. I didn't say that. It doesn't set well. Where I just struggle with that part of it. But it's just talk to people like that are like-minded or that know more than you and that have more experience because you can learn something from anybody. So it's listening and using your resources. You know, we tell all of our coaches in here that every member in here has something for you to learn from them, so make sure you're listening. Like, don't ever think that you know more than them. And that's with everybody. Like, you should take this with them. You know, like, listen to everybody you can because try to learn something from somebody every day.
Right.
And that used to not be how I thought at all. I think a lot of it was just post high school, early college days. I worked at as a merchandiser at Pepsi. Like, here's your store, go finish it up. Like, however you got to finish it, do it. Got it. If you ever see the boss, it means something's wrong. Okay, always do your job. You know, never asking questions. Just do it. Working at Snap Fitness as an independent trainer, like you have your own rules. You know, you do your own stuff. You charge your own rates. You do your own hours. Like, that's all I knew. So I think I got really sucked into that mindset, that lifestyle.
Yeah.
And it really deterred me.
It's good though that you at least came to, you know, where you are now, mm-hmm. this soon, because I feel like sometimes people don't ever.
Yeah. Be trapped. You're trapped, and it's hard to see the other side of it.
Oh yeah, you're in a little tunnel, and you have.
And you don't. And again, as we were saying earlier, you don't know what you don't know, so you have no idea that there's another part of it that exists. Like it's incomprehensible to you. Like, no way, that's not how people talk. Like, that's not what people do. They don't sit in a group of four guys making a video talking about a like mind, you know, fitness and health. Like, there's no way.
Right.
And you know, now we're part of a mastermind. Heading out to California in a couple weeks, and there's like 30, 40, 50 other gyms in the nation. I don't know who's showing up, but we just talk.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
Like, it's so cool, and we've talked to several other gyms in the area. Like, we've communicated with like Anthony Dix from Fitness Lying Down, and Devin and Kevin from Journey Active, Jake Dohorst over at UDX, CrossFit UDX. Like, there's communication there. Harrison over at Studio 16, like there's that happening here in La Crosse now. So it's a growth mindset type of thing. So it's happening, and I think part of that is also because, like, the mindset of I'm in has shifted. Mm-hmm. You know, where I think if I would have thought like I was 5 years ago, 6 years ago, like, I'm like, oh yeah, screw those guys. Like, yeah. They're no good. Like, this is the place to go.
Right. There's enough of that.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. And it's just is what it is. Like, you can't escape it.
Right.
But we've referred people to other gyms. Like, hey, it's not a good fit. Like, you're on the north side of La Crosse, I got a perfect gym for you. Call this guy up, and I'll message him right away. Okay, I'm sending somebody over to you. Like, be on the lookout for this call. I'll like, answer it right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that all comes back to you. That's from what I've heard.
Yeah.
You
just,
exactly. You just do it. Too. It doesn't seem like it, but it does.
Yep.
One way or the other.
Yeah.
Well, they always have your reputation.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. So.
And they can come to you when you open another. Right. North side, okay.
That was my question, is what's next for you guys when you're setting up the other building?
Yeah, we've been asked that a lot. I can't tell you, like, so we were super close to going to Holman, like, inches. It just didn't quite fit well. My mom owned a business up there, and we really looked into the demographics, and it was close. Really nice space, like 11,000 square feet. Mm-hmm. Rent was less than this building, like, right in the main drag, Festival Foods there. I mean, ideal. And I think it scared me a little bit.
Yeah.
But then it was just a lot of Holman, from what I was looking into, was still growing, so they were still so new. They were still coming to La Crosse for everything. Mm. You know, now Holman's still there, like, school district-wise, like, number one in the state.
Yeah.
New festival going up, new library.
Going up. Yeah, just all of this stuff happening. And, I know Eupraxia is going up there now. CrossFit went out. They were up there for a while. They have Ironworks. You know, they have B-Fit. Mm-hmm. But someday, Northside, probably. But I know I got to figure out how to run location before we open.
There you go.
Yeah, so, minor detail.
Yeah.
Knowing that is huge.
Yeah, we're working on growing this. Like, ideally, I'd like to have a bigger, twice the size of this facility with two classroom spaces to have two classes at once.
Yeah.
You know, because a lot of times, like, our classes are getting booked and our training, we have 8 people out here training in this space. You know, so if we could have a bigger training space, double the size, and then 2 classes, like, that's...
Be set.
Yeah, both at 5 o'clock, both at 6 o'clock, so you don't have to worry about time. Like,
there you go.
Right now, if we had another class, it's going to be at 7 o'clock at night. You know, 5 people want to train at that time.
Yeah.
So just keep growing Unity, keep getting the results, and keep the eyes open. You know, I don't see it happening within the next... You know, we're going to be here for a couple more years yet, but I don't plan on opening a second location anytime within that time.
Yeah.
This one is hard enough.
Yeah.
There you go.
Can imagine.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, where awesome. Can people find you?
They can find us on Facebook. So one of the downfalls that I haven't got around to is that we have like a different tag name or username for like everything that we have.
Yeah.
So we're
Twitter
giving,
screwed us. We couldn't fit the whole name in there. Yeah, right. So it's like abbreviations.
And we're on Facebook at Unity Fitness Lacrosse. There's only one Unity Fitness, but I just wanted to make sure like they knew it started on lacrosse when they found us. Yeah. You know, someday.
Yeah.
Let's see. We're UnityFitnessPro.com. We're Unity Fitness Pro on Twitter. That we don't really do a whole lot of tweeting from. More following. We're Unity Fitness. Lax, L-A-X, on Instagram. Yeah, Facebook and the website is where most of our marbles are at, so that'd be the easiest way to get a hold of us.
Send out a weekly or...
Yeah.
I don't know, is it weekly? I feel like I don't pay attention
weekly,
close enough, but I know I get it.
Yeah, weekly
and I
newsletter.
Check it out. Okay.
Weekly newsletter. We send out like motivational, inspirational stuff, like stuff that's usually it's personal to me that I read in like a business type of thing or coaching type of thing that I relate it to fitness. I try to do that on Mondays, usually a recipe on every Thursday. Anything else that's coming in, I'll try and funnel that through. So we do have a newsletter. We have you can access that on our website. There's a 21-day jumpstart on there that essentially just gives you the full experience here to jumpstart something in your health and fitness. Again, it doesn't have to be with us long term, but as long as we're part of the journey to getting them moving, the 21-day jumpstart gets them classes and training sessions to give them the full experience of what fitness could be for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's all online. But yeah, the names are all different.
We'll link them all up. So
yeah,
they'll find it.
There's different ones. I remember like we were doing the marketing stuff with UWL, and they're like, so do you think you can make the names all the same? Probably someday. Probably should have thought about that.
Yeah, Google can find it.
Yeah, if you look hard enough, Google will find it for you.
We're on there. But yeah, Facebook, we're on all the time. Like that's a pretty big thing for us. That's
awesome.
Where a lot of our growth has come from. So.
Good deal.
Cool.
Well, sounds good.
Thanks for appreciate it.
Bring yeah, us out thanks, here. Guys. It's been awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
Absolutely.
Good talking to you, hearing the whole story.
Yeah.
Got it now.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. It's been a journey so far, man. Like you came to the resolutions, the revolutions thing.
Yep.
I had this as a goal, like by the time I turned 30, but I thought I needed to have 10 years experience, like the masters, you know, get enough knowledge in there, and then we're kind of thrown into it.
Yeah, trial by fire. It's a good,
yeah,
right. Good way to learn.
It's the best way to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. Just do it. So, yeah, it's all worked out, and we're still growing. Like we're the busiest now we've ever been, and now it's learning how to manage. Like we struggled with 70 people, like how to manage that. Now we're at 90, so we're struggling. Like
there's never a perfect time.
Right,
go.
You learn
good problems
how to
have.
Do that.
All right.
So it's cool. Like it's just like when they say like. Listen, people on the money side of things, like, oh, if you want to make this much money, you have to learn how to spend that much, and you have to learn how to invest, and you have to learn how to do this, and then if you want to make that much money, there's different things you have to do.
You know?
That's what I relate to our members here, too. You know, it's how we do things. So the coaches are becoming more involved now, so I don't have 90 people asking me questions.
There you
that's
go.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Delegation.
Yeah, right. Delegation.
Nice.
So,
cool.
Yeah, it's been fun.
All right.
Well, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Nice chatting with you.
Thank you for checking out this episode of Clinically Pressed. Go to clinicallypressed.com for full show notes and links to everything that was covered in this episode. While you're there, you have access to all of our episodes, insights, and shorts. You can find Clinically Pressed on YouTube and any podcast outlet. If you could give us a rating, thumbs up, or review on how we are doing, we would greatly appreciate it. To get more free content delivered to your inbox, sign up for the Total Athletic Therapy newsletter. You'll get direct links to all new Clinically Pressed episodes, reviews on some of the latest research in health and performance, and links to related podcasts and other items meant to help you make the complicated simple and optimize performance. Thank you for listening, and see you next episode.